Good evening and welcome to Open Your Mind Radio. You have myself, Alan James.
And you have myself, Stephen George. Good evening.
Good evening. It's Sunday the 14th of September 2014 and our guest on the show tonight is a chap called Lyon Zagami. I'll be finding all about the Illuminati and all that kind of stuff and finding out what's going on there. And we'll be talking to Lyon in a few minutes, but we have a few things to go through. But first of all, we'll find out what the communication channels are.
Okay, Mary, communication channels, please.
The communication channels are email info@oymireland.com, by phone 046 927 1212, and you can also contact us direct through the OYM chat room.
Thank you, Mary. 046 927 1212 is the number for the studio this evening. We also have the chat room as well is open for business. If you want to log on over there, it's oymradio.com. You'll see the large button on the left-hand side. Just click there, log in with your real name or a pseudonym. You can chat amongst yourselves. You can also pose questions there for our special guest this evening. And if you want to check out our Facebook page, I always forget to mention, we do have a Facebook page as well. There is a link on the left-hand side of the website as well. You can check that out as well. And also the YouTube channel. We do have a live YouTube channel also. Now, Alan.
Steve, okay, myself and Steve are actually watching Sam broadcast like a hawk.
Yes.
Because of it being temperamental. Now, I did an update during the week and we got the latest version of Sam broadcaster. So fingers crossed it's okay. It was okay yesterday, which I did the United We Strike radio marathon yesterday, and we had a great marathon, loads of great guests on the show, and it works flawlessly, so I can't complain. Now, there is one show which I do recommend. If there's one show that I recommend that you should go over and listen to on United We Strike, is a chap called Dr. Joseph Chapallone, whose background, he's born in Italy, and he was talking about the end times of the planet and what's going on. And I found that, personally, I found the interview very good. So pop over there, you can download it or just play it and have a listen. Very, very interesting interview that he did there with Detlev. Now, the other thing was, we, on our OYM hotline, a listener phoned in from Sweden, and he wanted to know if Chris Thomas is going to be back on the show for part two. Well, unfortunately, Chris won't be on the show for a while, and because we have been in touch with Chris, he's busy doing his own thing. But the listener didn't actually leave any email or a phone number, so we can't get back to you in Sweden. So if anybody does ring in on the OAM hotline, please leave your name and number or email so we can get back to you if you want us to return. If the question that you want us to answer, please leave your details there. Steve, over to you.
Yes. Unfortunately, and I say unfortunately with a tongue in cheek, some of our Irish politicians are being very, very upset. They're very upset about being bullied online. I wish I had a button here when I pressed it. We just go, aww.
Yeah, actually, I was going to. You know what we should have done?
What?
You have the sad music there on it.
Ah, okay. Right. Well,
that's what you should. That's what you should have played. Okay. Okay.
Okay. There's some sad music going in the background. Okay. Yeah. Anyway, according to a survey carried out by the Irish Examiner, it seems that 82% of Irish politicians have received abusive comments on social media. As reported by the Examiner's Kelly O'Brien, speaking about his own experience with cyberbullying, Wexford TD Paul Keogh said that he had received extremely serious threatening and abusive tweets, while Dublin North TD Alan Farrell said he might be a politician, but he is also a person who can be hurt by such attacks. A human person with feelings? I don't think so.
No.
I'm sorry. Yeah, I mean, look, Enda Kenny has skin like a rhino. Yeah, he does, and he has the face to match. But no, I'm sorry. A politician's being upset by nasty comments online. I'm sorry. As far as I'm concerned, it goes cap in hand with the nature of the, you know, what they're doing. If you're gonna go and stab people in the back, promise people this, that, and the other on the doorstep when it's coming up to an election, and then do a 360, and instead of putting out your hand, you know, when they arrive on your doorstep, the hand goes out for you to shake it, and as soon as you vote them in, the same hand goes around, but they're giving you the middle finger now. They're not shaking your hand, and I'm awfully sorry, but if you do that to people, you have to expect some negativity in return. So to all those TDs, those 82% of the Irish politicians, sorry to hear that. Boo.
Yeah, well, on the Alan's Wake, I want to kind of go into a bit more detail about that. So we'll talk about that in a minute. The other thing that's on the list is a spokesperson for Anti-Eviction Ireland says Eileen O'Neill of Clontarf outside Drumaway was noticeably shaken by the incident after she was told she would be arrested if she did not leave the house within a certain time period. This is regarding a house repossession. The representative of Pepper Finance called to Mrs. O'Neill, whose son Michael was jailed a week earlier in relation to a loan at 8:50 p.m. last Friday night. So they called to her house at 8:50 p.m. last Friday night. Obviously they're chasing her. Now, when is it that if her son has taken out a loan and he's over 18, that they go chase the mother? It's nothing got to do with her. It's her son's loan, and he got jailed, and now they're after her. And I've heard this from a friend of mine as well, that a friend of mine's father died of cancer, and the bank started chasing after his wife for his credit card debt. So, you know, needless to say, I told her what to tell the bank, because her name is not on it, and it wasn't her.
Definitely
contract.
Not. But I mean, this one that you're speaking of here, there's no. She's not guarantor on the loan by any chance.
Well, I don't know the nitty gritty, but if he's over 18 and he's gone to jail, then chances are, you know, if you're over 18, there's no guarantor on it if it's just a loan.
Well, unless he was unemployed. I mean, if he was unemployed and got a loan, he wouldn't need a guarantor. So
yeah. Well, I can understand that. Yeah. Do they still do guarantor these days? That was years ago, did they?
Oh yes.
Okay.
The bank wants, trust me, the bank wants to know, if that happens to you, who do we go to extract the money from?
Yeah.
You know.
Who do we know?
Who do we send the boys around to?
Yeah, exactly, yeah. How's your week anyway?
My week's fine. It's the usual mix of fun and frolics. I think I mentioned last week about some people in my place of employment who had started to wake up and ask me for information about return to sender. I touched base with them during the week, and one of them had done the return to sender. She said she read all the information that I gave her, and she checked out the video of Harry from We the People explaining the process. The other lady in question, she hadn't done it yet, but it was on the cards, although she had given some of the information in relation to the return to sender to other family members. Kind of staying on that subject, there's a couple of friends of mine on Facebook. The great thing about Facebook is you can kind of hook up with people who you haven't seen in years, old schoolmates and so on and so forth. I have a few schoolmates on it that I went to primary school with, so that's kind of that's back in the day. That's 100 years ago, and the topic came up of one of them got his papers in, and he was wondering who on here is going to sign and return the paperwork to Irish Water. A lot of people come on and said no, that they weren't going to do it. One of the lads come on and he explained, yes, I am going to fill it out and return it, and here's the reason why. Because the property charge, the property tax, the household charge, whatever you want to call it, he got that deducted at source. He wasn't going to pay it, but it was deducted then at source. Revenue came in, and I then jumped in. I didn't miss the opportunity. I explained to them that Irish Water, being a private company, that they would not be able to do that. It was a little bit of to-ing and fro-ing. A lot of people agreed. So he may change his mind, I don't know. But from what I've seen on just that one post, I'd say there's probably maybe 40, 50 people had actually replied to it. And out of the 40 or 50, two people said that they were actually prepared to pay these water charges. The rest of them, the other 99%, I shall call them, they were all saying no. Then again, you know, people say a lot of things. You don't know what they're going to do in the end. What else on the radar? I put a link up the top of the chat box earlier this afternoon, and I just thought it was interesting, because we often hear about people going around trying to serve you with papers. Anyone who, you know, who has been served with papers, you know, unless you've got them in your hand, well, you haven't been served. But recently, it seems an Irish judge has allowed papers to be served via a LinkedIn account. I kid you not. It's on the top of the chat. You can read all the nitty-gritty about it, but I'll just give you a few snippets. It says, Declan De Lacy, Director of Advisory and Insolvency at PKF O'Connor, noted that the liquidators had tried to serve papers, but that an individual could not be reached except through a LinkedIn account. This is the second case in Ireland, seemingly, where a judge has granted approval to serve proceedings via social media. 2 years ago, Judge Pert allowed for an order to be served using the social media site Facebook. So that's the way we're going now. So, you know, if they're going to come after you with some paperwork, and if they can't get you through the normal channels, they're now going to go through your Facebook account or your LinkedIn or God knows what else. I think that's so wrong. It's overstepping the boundaries, as far as I'm concerned. Anyway, make up your own mind on that one. Last thing on my list is there was a video on the YouTube during the week of some protesters shouting abuse at Irish water workers. Now, don't get me wrong, I've no love lost for anyone, really, at all. But I did think that the abuse that was coming from the so-called peaceful protesters was way bang out of order. It was over and above the call of duty, it really was. You know, it was supposed to be a peaceful protest. The people from Irish Water stopped what they were doing as soon as the protest started. They actually stopped what they were doing. They clumped together in a group. They didn't look Irish. Some of them actually, most of them looked foreign. And to be totally honest with you, they looked bewildered. They had a look on their faces of just fear. That's all I can describe it. So, someone was saying, oh yeah, this is what they deserve, blah, blah, blah. I just jumped on, I said, I agree with the protest. I agree with the protesters. However, I don't agree with the insults being flung at these people who, at the end of the day, were just doing a job. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not supporting Irish Water in any way, shape or form. But these guys, they were just sent out to do a job and they were getting abuse left, right and centre. They weren't retaliating. They weren't throwing insults back. They weren't hitting anyone with barriers, although we have heard that has happened in the past. But I think it was out of order, so I put a comment in relating to that. And needless to say, I got the, you know what, kicked, well, cyber kicked out of me on YouTube, because a lot of people come in then saying, oh, Irish Water started it and blah, 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 and you know, this is the way it's gone. They drew forced blood and this is what you have to do. And I said, I'm sorry. And actually, one of them, Alan, would you believe, he said to me, all you are is a keyboard warrior. You need to grow a set of cojones.
Near riding.
Yeah. And, you know, get out on the street. This is where it is. And I said, hang on. I wrote back to this one chap. I said, hang on a second. First of all, I said, you've insulted me. You know nothing about me and you're casting aspirations, you know, on me and my character. I said, you don't know me. I said, I'm involved in this and I can tell you that what you were doing with your approach is, you know, with the so-called peaceful approach, the peaceful protest. I said, it's attitudes like that. And from what I seen on the YouTube video, I said, that's what turns peaceful protests into bloodbaths. And a couple of people actually came back and backed me up and said, yeah, there was no need for the abusive language. If you wanted to ask a question, all they were asking, Sammy, was they wanted to see Irish Water workers, their paperwork, to prove, like, I don't know, safety statement or whatever it was. But you had five or six or seven people all roaring and shouting at the same time. And you know yourself, when everyone's shouting, no one gets heard.
Yeah.
So it was a complete waste of time. But, you know, look, what do you do? I just threw my two cents worth, and you know, a lot of people didn't agree. So as far as I'm concerned, there are a lot of people out there who are protesting for the right reasons, and there are probably some people out there who are protesting for the wrong reasons. And by that I mean, they're going out and they're having the protest, but they're ready for action, if you know what I mean. And probably a short fuse, and all it would take will be a wrong word or a wrong look from somebody, and that's when the violence will start. But anyway, again, I agree with the protest. I'm doing it myself, but I believe that there are different ways to get what we want. I believe we will win in the end, but not by violence. Anyway,
true.
Rant over. How's your week?
Well, my week, just a couple of interesting things during the week, I have to say. Now, this Nasara thing. Now, we will ask Leo about this when we get him on in a few minutes. I'm just interested in it, just out of curiosity. You know, we've heard stuff like this before, and it's all, you know, pie in the sky. But nothing happened, obviously, on the 9th of the 9th. And when you look at the paperwork and what people are writing, they're saying there was a delay of getting these funds released and everything else. Now, it's just funny enough that they talk about Iraq and the Iraqi government. And they said the Iraqi government had to get organised, and when they're organised, then that would be a push to go forward. And then during the week, Obama comes out and talks about Iraqi government being organised. And I thought, oh, that's interesting. And then during the week, on the Wednesday or Thursday, I think it was the Thursday, I went to do some online banking, and the Bank of Ireland servers had gone down. And they were down for most of the day. They came back up in the evening. Now, I don't know, I didn't try and log in, but the chap said they'd be back online by the evening. But the servers were down. And it's just funny that on this Nisara thing, they actually talk about, you know, the banks shutting down and then coming back up and changes of computer systems, which is quite interesting. So, again, I'm just kind of out of interest and have a bit of fun. I'm just keeping an eye on it and keeping a look at it. I don't know whether Leo's probably heard about this, so we can touch base with him on that when he comes on. The other thing is, just to make you aware, this is just a security tip regarding Windows software. Windows automatically has the remote access on your computer switched on. And this can be very dangerous for the likes of hacking or planting of information, because hackers can get in. And I don't know whether people know this, but you need to make sure that that's switched off. So if you, I'm just going to read out where you go regarding a Windows 7 machine. It's probably going to be the same with Vista, near enough, and Windows 8. But you go into your control panel, into System Security Settings, System.
You're going very fast.
System Protection. They can play this back. And podcast
all right.
is available.
I was going to just try and do it now.
Okay. Well, it's on the list. You can type while I'm talking.
Okay.
It's on there, unscripted script. So, Control Panel, System Security Settings, System Protection, Remote Tab, and Switch Off, Allow Remote Connections to the Computer. Because we know that people are, you know, Windows and, you know, the whole lot with that, it can be a bit, you know, flaky at times and insecure, and they have ways of getting in. And so I would just make sure that you have that remote access. Steve?
Just a quick question. Let's say, for argument's sake, if somebody like me was, if I go and I do this, and then I have a problem, a genuine problem with, let's say, I don't know, a piece of software that I own, I've bought it, and then I say to you, can you help me with this, because you're tech support and you use a program called TeamViewer.
Yeah.
Will this affect TeamViewer if we switch off this option?
I haven't tried it, but
okay.
I'd rather have it switched off and switch it on when I need it than have it on all the time just in case.
Right, so it would be probably beneficial then if you do switch this off and you do have to contact tech support and they do ask you to open up a TeamViewer window, you'll need to know how to allowed.
If TeamViewer doesn't work, yeah, okay. But just from a security point of view, I think it'd be very good if you do that. Check your own computer anyway. The other thing while Steve is typing away, before we can bring Leo in, is you've probably seen on Facebook, I sent a few emails to a few TDs in County Meath, just asking a few questions, and I kind of had a query regarding Josephine Feely's article with Vin, which Vin found on the Inland Revenue website regarding the we tax by consent, and she mentions it about four times, and she includes the local property tax. And I asked the TDs during the week, and for the ones that did reply back, remember they were public representatives, and I got standard emails back from the politicians. Now, one politician who was the best out of the bunch was a chap called Ray Butler Fine Gael. And Ray did go on and say to me that he has been through hard times and he lost the business, and which is fine. And I maybe that's why we were getting good, you know, a bit of communication between the two of us. But what I can't understand is, if this guy has gone through, he's lost the business and he's had hard times, why the hell is he agreeing with his party that's voting for austerity? You know, surely if you've been through hard times and you know what it's like, the last thing you want to put on the people is to go through the experience that you've been through and putting on them. And I asked them that question. And of course, they didn't reply back. So it really, really proved to me during the week. Oh, by the way, you probably heard that Josephine Feely she's going to be stepping down from the Inland Revenue.
Oh, what have you done?
I didn't do anything. I didn't do anything.
Oh, yeah, I think you did.
No, I didn't do anything.
You are directly responsible for that woman leaving her job.
Yeah, and
she's a career politician since when?
She's been there since 1993, and just happens this week she's decided to step down from her role.
Right, so she's there since the early 90s. You send her an email, and now she's stepping down. I don't know. I mean, I'm joining the dots here, and I'm starting to see a picture.
I did send an email to Josephine, and I asked her about her article, and she never got back to me, so I'm a bit disappointed.
Not tonight, Josephine.
Not tonight, Josephine, exactly. So yeah, that was a bit strange that old Josephine is stepping down. But she did say that, you know, no consent. Basically, four times she mentions it, and she's the Inland Revenue chairman of the Inland Revenue, or was, who's stepping down. So if she's turning around and saying that we are in a representative democracy and they tax by consent, then why are we, surely if we now say no consent, they should go away and say, okay, that's great. Why are we being bullied and intimidated and coerced by the Inland Revenue for that? Okay, we'll have to go back to that. Anyway, it's time to get our guest on. Now, our guest is a chap called Lyon Zagami. He's an ex-member of the, he's a high-level member, ex-high-level member of the Italian Illuminati, 33rd degree Mason. He's was a senior member of the infamous P2 Lodge, was the prince prepared to take over after the old Illuminati King passed away, and born of Scottish-Sicilian Illuminati aristocratic bloodline, and being involved in the Illuminati Order since childhood, and he's now disgusted with satanic black magic rituals, and with true intentions with those regard themselves as the elite controllers to the planet, he's committed to tell the real story of and seek the expose what's been going on. And I think he's been through the run of the mill with the Illuminati because of what he's done. So we'll find out a bit more about Lyon. So good evening, Lyon. How are you doing?
Very well. Good evening to all your listeners.
Thank you for coming on, Lyon. Much appreciated. Before we actually get into talking about the Illuminati and everything else, just kind of give us an expanded version, a little bit of an expanded version of your background, because obviously you're not just an author and a writer, but you have been involved. You've said you've been involved in the Illuminati. So tell us how that all came about.
Well, it came about because of my family background. I decided at one point in 2006, after a few years of squabbles within the order, to manifest outwards what was my discontent and create in that way a fracture with this new world order, which is of course created by a series of secret societies of sects which we commonly refer to as the Illuminati. I started these revelations on the internet in 2006 and between 2006 and 2008, I mainly worked with the internet, though I discovered that the internet was a good medium to get my story in the immediate out. So, you know, this will actually stop who was after me and maybe wanted to even hurt me from doing so. But it actually didn't work so well because I still got arrested, I still got accused of espionage, still got persecuted, but I didn't stop my revelations, and from 2009 I started to write books about it because I think that in the book format I can write things that are a little bit more credible with more evidence in them than just a page on the internet. And by doing that, I got out 6 books in Japan and other 6 in Italy. And from next year, I will start publishing finally in the English language. And my last work, which is the first one to come out in English language, is dedicated to the present situation of Pope Francis and the question mark if he's the last pope or not. So Pope Francis, the last pope, is my last work. But my Confession Trilogy will soon come after, and this Confession Trilogy has created also some shockwaves within Italian Freemasonry. You can go and check yourselves within also very serious publications and newspapers like Italia Oggi reported about these shockwaves within Italian Freemasonry due to the fact that I brought a lot of documented evidence on the corruption of certain lodges, of certain infiltrations of certain institutions, and also the connection with the Vatican. And so I explain a bit better who were the Illuminati, the Academy of the Illuminati, born in 2001 with Giuliano Di Bernardo. 2001-2002 they created this dignity lodge in Switzerland, this base with the Marquis of Southampton, which was at the time the Deputy Grand Master of the United Kingdom Lodge of England. and together with the Israeli Grand Lodge, they have worked out a new version of the Illuminati in the modern era called the Academy of the Illuminati. But the Illuminati and the various branches have always continued to exist, not only in myth, like some historians claim, because there is such a complex history behind these secret societies. That's why I tend to go more in depth during my publications. But just to cut a long story short, we can say that Adam Weishaupt's initial, what is known as the Order of the Illuminati, founded in 1776, was just an emanation of a long-standing tradition of Illuminati that goes back to the ancient times, that evolved into the Rosicrucian tradition, also evolved in other branches of the Illuminati, like the Illuminati of Avignon, and it created also two different branches of Freemasonry, one the more Roman Catholic, a more continental one, that then filtered more into the ancient and accepted Scottish Rite, or the Hanoverian one, which is the British one, the one which is controlled by the United Grand Lodge of England, historically, which recognizes all the other Grand Lodges after the foundation. And they divided, let's say, the power between these two structures by stating that you had to be initiated into the first 3 degrees, so you had to depend from a recognition, official recognition, from the order, so from the classic Masonic structure, which is under the Hanoverians, and at the same time, you could go into these rites of perfection, which gave birth, though, to some revolutionary people that, of course, created their own nation based on these principles, which is the United States of America. But all of this is a plan, is all planned, so they could ultimately all control the same structure, which is the New World Order. So all these organizations that seemingly sometimes we see conflicting with each other are working towards this process. And in this process is very important the game played by the religions, the main Abrahamic faiths, in leading this scenario of end of time scenario we have in front of us, because of course the council of religions is the ultimate process of the New World Order to create the one world religion. Of course, to manipulate the whole thing, they have to use some people which are instrumental for them, and those are at this moment of time the Muslim fundamentalists, because they have worked a lot behind manipulating them and being able to knowing their traditions. The CIA in the 70s devised this new vamp of Islamic fundamentalism. It didn't exist, and now it exists again, because there was, of course, a secret operation conducted by the West together with the Israeli and, of course, the Mossad. So all of this gives us this end-of-time scenario in the Middle East also at present, which is in line, of course, with the prophecies, but is also manifested by these people who are living within these secret societies or within certain knighthoods, within a certain elite. So they are themselves trying to manifest the end of times. This is not only common to Christianity, but also to the Islamic faith, where also the Shiites, more than others, but also now the Sunni with the ISIS, are trying to manifest this end of time scenario, because they feel that will lead to the coming back of the Mahdi, and then the Messiah of the Christians, which is also talked about in the Quran, which is Jesus, will lead this judgment scenario. We were talking before we started the show about also the prophecies of Malachi. You mentioned something about the Black Pope, I remember, no?
Yeah, just before we went live, yeah.
Well, in reality, Malachi never talked about Black Pope. There's no reference in his supposed 111 prophecies plus this code, this prophetic code. There is not a mention of it. Where does this Black Pope then arise, this myth of the Black Pope? Let's say that the Black Pope legend starts really in Rome, It's always been transmitted orally. At one point, then there was a researcher, around 2002, they published a book. And in this book, they basically stated, talked about this Caput Nigrum, this lost prophecy of Malachi. This research was conducted upon the fact that Malachi, at one point, who is, of course, an Irish saint, so, of course, you know much more about him than probably than myself, he came to Rome at one point, conducted a pilgrimage to the Holy City, and in this context is born this prophecy, because of course he supposedly learned about this oral tradition, which communicates that at one point there will be a black pope, and that is the last pope. Now, it didn't manifest in the color, of course. Pope Bergoglio is not black, but he is a Jesuit. For some, this is, of course, in line with these prophecies, because of the fact that the prepost general, the one who conducts the Jesuit order, is called the Black Pope, usually. So there is this thing about the fact that a Jesuit pope is, of course, a black pope. And there is definitely some strange things occurring at the Vatican right now. I talk about them in depth in my publications, but definitely they are, I can say that the prophecies have got a certain basis in reality when you actually compare with what is happening at the moment. We saw, for example, in Ireland, what happened with the Murphy Commission, no? And we saw also that the Murphy Commission didn't get anything out of the Vatican, so because the Vatican refused. They wanted a more formal approach. They invented a million excuses. At the time, there was this Cardinal Bertone. Now, Cardinal Bertone, who is the ex-Secretary of State, because now you have the new one called Parolin, he works together with this Academy of the Illuminati, which officially is based in Rome, in Piazza di Spagna, but in reality it has other basis, but in any case is well connected with this, also with the Jesuit structure, and it works. I would say they are the dark side, because nowadays the plan devised by this new world order is diabolical. There is nothing that is not diabolical about this plan, and destroying the sacrality of the Pope was an object, that had to be accomplished. And they did that with the resignation of Ratzinger. So they destroyed the sacrality of the Pope. Nowadays, they're even trying to destroy the sacrality of the Dalai Lama. The Dalai Lama himself said that there will not be any future Dalai Lama. I mean, how can you say that when you are supposed to be an immortal, somebody that reincarnates? Are you going to stop the process of reincarnation? I mean, but this is in the New World Order plan, the destruction of the sacrality of any religious leader is something important. So, because they don't want anything sacred or anything divine to preside their council of religions and their ultimate plan, which should unveil on the world approximately in 6 years.
Right, okay, well, just talking about the New World Order, and as you say, you came out to expose maybe the positive side of the Illuminati, if you want to call it that, are getting upset with a certain element within.
Absolutely, I represent those people that with me have standed in the last few years against this dark plan, this mondialization, this globalization, that we don't, absolutely, we refuse. In fact, if you go on the internet, you will still find traces of the internal struggle that I had in the Monte Carlo Lodge between 2006 and 2008, which ended up with me bringing out of the fold of the Monte Carlo Lodge, and so of the P2 originated lodge in Monte Carlo, my Ordo Illuminatorum Universalis, because I didn't want to have anything to do with anymore with these people who were using even interreligious dialogue just as a tool of manipulation. And so It's of course there is a lot of things at stake. For example, we have seen in Ukraine in the last year the crisis unfolding, no? And in this crisis we have seen also certain characters, certain schismatic realities of the Catholic Church which embraced the Orthodox rites, which actually in turn supported the Putin and actually asked Putin to intervene themselves at one point. And at the same time, they recently also launched an anathema. An anathema is something like a curse, no? In the Catholic, but also in the Christian tradition, is something very particular. You don't just throw it like this. They did a video, which you can trace on the internet, of the head of this church, this Byzantine Catholic church in Russia, which basically is cursing Pope Francis because of his liberal ways, because he has been not honest in how he's approaching also the subject of homosexuality, for example, in the clergy. He is not also honest with the syncretistic New World Order approach that they are having when he invited all those religious leaders, for example, in the Vatican. Something really happened in there, you know, that a lot of people should meditate upon, because for the first time in history, we actually had somebody praying, Muslim praying with words from the Quran, and all this will be fine and dandy, as the British would say, but it wasn't fine and dandy, because if you translate the last phrase said in Arabic, it says that basically they were cursing all the non-believers in Allah and in the Quran. So you don't do that, of course, when you are the guest of the Vatican praying inside the Vatican. Of course, the ignorance of the people around it, and the Vatican itself, the Vatican radio said, no, they never said this, but there is a recording, there is experts in Arabic that have translated the phrase, and of course they went behind the back, even or probably of the Pope, or not, that's the thing, or not. There is maybe a plan which we don't know about, and this plan is of course the Islamization of the West, and it's part of this scenario, ongoing scenario. So I'm doing my job, trying to make people aware of certain realities. I've also got involved for a brief period also here in Italy in politics, thinking there might be the reason to change things. But I understood that with this kind of enemy, you can't really oppose them, because they will crush you. They will really crush you. So, you know, it's not easy then to fight somebody when we ourselves are endorsing the means whereby they can control us.
Yeah.
That can be the iPhone 6 or that can be the last smartphone of any. When we are gonna be capable of making payments with the smartphone, and that will, in the future, transform in a microchip presence, like the patriarch of Russia said, Kirill, we will be in front of something which is diabolical, in front of the mark of the beast. Now, the difference between the Catholic Church and the Orthodox Church is that the Orthodox Church in the last 2 years has really fought an internal struggle so they could actually acknowledge these things. And they actually acknowledge them at a public level. And they condemned the use, even by Putin, if he wanted to microchip or use the microchip to identify people, because they said that in turn this will lead to some racial disputes, to disputes also about the religious belief that one might have recorded in your chip, you know, when you go around, and already now in your passport. So what I'm saying here is that in Russia we have fought an internal war within the Orthodox Church to actually free the Orthodox Church of this mondialist. There was at one point an attempt made in May of 2012, a very important meeting took place in Astana. You know Astana, where they have the big pyramid, which you probably saw.
I think we heard about that, yeah.
In 2012, they had a meeting, this interreligious meeting, in which they nominated the patriarch Kirill from Russia as a member of this Council of Religions. And this pyramid where the meeting took place, you can see it on the internet, is of course something which resembles the classical Illuminati pyramid you see in the $1 bill. And the patriarch went there. After he went there, though, he had to face some very harsh criticism within his own church and also within certain schismatic factions. And so at the end, he and Putin have decided to try to get out of this whole thing, because they felt that it was really basically just drawing them inside the New World Order trap. And by doing this, then the whole conflict with Ukraine was naturally then created by the agents of the West, together with the European agents, of course, with American support, and what's happening now in Ukraine is the result of this. So this, on a world scenario, we have a nation that is very much connected with their own religious institution, which is the Orthodox Church in Russia, that wanted to rebel to this New World Order scenario, which, of course, you can still rebel now to it, but in 10 years from now, you will have to accept the microchip if you want to go around Europe freely, if you want to come back into Europe, because the borders at one point in 2020 will be closed for people who don't have the microchip. So,
okay, so just touching base on that, you just said that Putin... is, you reckon Putin is now moving away from the New World Order, and this is why they haven't the conflict, the made-up conflict. They've created that themselves, and obviously, you know, Al-Qaeda moved away, and all of a sudden ISIS just come in and took over. And we know that, we've heard that ISIS have been trained by the Americans and the CIA and stuff like that. And they're trying to antagonize Putin into a war, because that's what they want. Now, one of the things that I was reading, we have a question here, funny enough, it's the same thing. You know, you probably heard of Benjamin Fulford. And Benjamin Fulford said on one of his posts that the powers that war, rather than the powers to be, the New World Order, are, you know, it's like a dying lion. And you don't go up and antagonize a dying lion, you just let the lion die and it'll gradually die and that's it. Now, obviously, they know that they're losing the game, and this is I've been doing a lot of research.
Okay, can I say something about Benjamin Fulford? Because I worked with Fulford, I actually released two books with him, so I know the subject very well.
Okay, yeah.
Unfortunately, I discovered, and I actually exposed him in my own trilogy with documents and photos, I exposed his membership to what are known commonly as the Chinese triads, the Chinese Freemasonry, connected, of course, intern with American intelligence and with the NSA general, which is General Alexander. I have actually printed on documents that demonstrate this in my publications. And basically, since then, of course, Fulford called me Satanist, whatever, in retaliation. But what I'm saying is that the guy has not yet proven something in a substantial way. And when he makes a statement like, okay, the lion is dying, so let him die because it's at the end, he's actually giving you this information. The lion, if you intend as lion, the New World Order, is absolutely not dying, is in total control more than ever, and actually is closing up the last remaining lines of control, which is to impose in a soft way initially a technology which will bring you then, initially we have the Brave New World Huxley kind of approach, so known as soft dictatorship, but in 2024 we have the plan completing in a Orwellian 1984 nightmare, and that is total dictatorship. So I think that by saying things that are disinformation like that, you're just planting in the people the idea that everything is going to go well and they're going to go and eat their pizza, going to go with their mates at the pub and not think about it. No, the problem doesn't end up there. We are right in it, in the deep of, and I don't want to say the word because, of course, there is kids listening, but we are in a deep, and that's it.
Okay.
Meaning there is no lion that is dying, because there is no way that this lion is dying at the moment, because to make eventually the elite change, it will mean first of all, that all the people that you have elected to the European Parliament, or all the people you have elected in Parliament, are a bunch of fools. And so you should just keep them out right now, because they are all compromised with power. Every one of them, from A to Z. So, and they are compromised with the church. Like when we had the pedophile scandal in Ireland, we saw the compromise between the church and the police. So we're still talking about things like this when we had people like Jimmy Somerville in Great Britain doing what they did, supported by the powers to be. We can say one thing for sure. The world is conducted by pedophiles and by people who have, of course, a lot of money and wealth. Spiritually, they might be dying. I mean, spiritually, I can acknowledge, in that case, Fulford, that they are dying as a spiritual creature, because they don't have any more spirituality. They are completely zombies, because the more they gather this materialistic strength, the more they show their weakness in the spiritual side. Mm. But in any case, they are in control.
Okay, well, the reason why, I mean, that's brilliant, because we can't verify Benjamin Fulford's background. So, you know, we can only go by what he's saying. And I don't take, I do read what he has to say.
Benjamin,
but I don't take
your background is very easy.
Yeah.
He comes from a family of diplomats. He comes from a family of people close to the elite. He was actually the Forbes editor in chief for the Middle East.
Yeah.
To become the Forbes editor in chief for the Middle East, you have to be part of the elite. So Fulford has always been part of the elite. At one point, he has decided to give certain information from within the fold. But this information is simply not accurate all the time, because they are paying him. They are making sure that he doesn't deliver the ultimate truth. I mean, when I started to deliver the ultimate truth on also even on Fulford by showing documents which I found in his own house and photographed them, I mean, then people started to say, oh, well, maybe there is something going on here. And then they acknowledge the fact that the guy is not credible. But like him, there is many not credible individuals who want to give you the ultimate information. But of course, like Fulford or like Infowars or many other, you have to pay and then you get the ultimate information. There is no ultimate information. I mean, because what you really should need to do in that case, if you want to become acknowledged like an Illuminati, you have to study a lot. And you have to basically study everything within the realms of geopolitics, economy, religion, and all the rest, but at certain levels. Of course, Fulford, as an economist, knows very well what he's doing behind the scenes by bringing up every now and then these bonds. These bonds existed. These bonds existed. They were actually smuggled into Italy. They were at least three times confiscated officially by the Italian finance police. They were found, this Japanese, the first time was in Chiasso on the borders with Switzerland. Later on, they were found more bonds with some Filipinos, I think it was in an airport. And a similar other thing happened in another place. So basically, billions of bonds, which were critically, I mean, they would create panic if they were actually put on the market and turned to real money tomorrow morning. They would create the collapse of an entire economic system. But they are used as a threat. They are signals that the Chinese every now and then launch to the West. You have to understand that China is very powerful, but China doesn't play at the New World Order game 100%. They want to be amongst the conductors of the New World Order. So every now and then, when their partners, like in Israeli or in the Vatican or in America, do something, they launch a signal. And that signal is received, and then they don't move maybe doing something that they shouldn't have done. You know, I mean, they stop whatever they were doing. So these are all people that are in league. There is a great game. Of course, Russia is showing a bit of muscles, but let's say that Russia is also has accepted since the time of Gorbachev the New World Order. There is a lot of things that Russia has compromised with since the time of the Soviet Union. And nowadays it's very difficult to get out of that compromise for Putin. At the same time, they have a lot of strength because, you know, they're rich in oil, they're rich in diamonds, they're rich in various things. And so they can really create, they have the ammunition for the war, but the war in any case was planned at, you know, on top of it all.
Yeah.
Because when you are enemies, you know, you have enemies. For example, the enemy is Obama fronting Putin. How many people you have in the room? Two people.
Mm.
Okay? That's it. And then you have, of course, their advisors. It can be Kissinger, it can be, you know, Rockefeller, it can be... But in the end, these people confront themselves every day on a structure which is planet Earth. There is a few people taking the decisions, and if they decided that is the time to go to war, they will go to war. Because ISIS is born also out of the necessity to get rid of a lot of weapons. Last week, I think 10 days ago, Italy decided to send some shipments of weapons to the Kurds to fight ISIS. They didn't send them new weapons. They sent them weapons that were confiscated from the mafia, weapons of Soviet-built weapons. Whatever. And today, for example, the president in Iraq said that, please give us some new weapons, because you can't fight ISIS with this stuff. It's old. And of course, but they had to get rid of it. They have, you know, they have a great economic interest. And in the world, the weapon industry is, of course, something we should condemn. As officially the Pope condemns in the last few speeches, he talked about the Third World War again, he already mentioned. So he's reiterating again and again that we are in the Third World War. He said it yesterday again. Today he said everybody that does the war is crazy. Yes. But maybe somebody should remind him that up until a few months ago, there was the head of the Treasury of the Knights of Malta in charge of Yor, who is a weapon dealer, one of the biggest ones in Germany, that most of the weapon dealers make business through the Yor, the Vatican Bank.
Mm.
So, I mean, this hypocrisy...
Yeah, it's rife. It's true. It's the same over here in Ireland. We have massive hypocrisy over here. But I'll tell you what, we're going to go off to questions, and there is a few questions. So, and if we can kind of condense the answers, that'd be great, because there's so much that we want to get through. So, one question could take up the whole show, I'm sure. But we'll try and condense them as well. But before we go off to the questions, I just want to ask you about this Nasara. Have you heard about this Nasara thing? Nasara. It's supposed to be the reset of the financial system and treasury bonds or treasury currency being issued.
No, I don't. I mean, it's the treasury bond subject which I was talking to you before, which was touched also by Fulford, is because there is some boxes around the world full of treasury bonds, immense quantities of it, that were located in different parts of the world because of political situations that maybe became then in the course of time outdated, so then they moved these assets from one part to the other of the world, and of course they can change the whole financial system. I haven't in particular heard of what you are describing.
Okay. And do you believe there is a society or a family? You know, again, Benjamin Fulford and Neil Keenan talk about the dragon family.
I studied very much in that subject, and in fact, in my books, I reveal exactly who is the dragon family. And the dragon family is basically just a cover-up name for the dragon family, as it's always been known, being the Chinese triads, the Hung Men, Freemasons, that Fulford belongs to, and I show also the documentation to that assess this. So, I mean, of course, people should believe in Chinese disinformation up to a certain extent. Because they are so powerful. Imagine they have even their own political party, which is the only one to side with the Communist Party within the Communist government. The Xiango, I think it's called Xiango Party or something like this, which includes only Chinese Freemasonry. And Chinese Freemasonry is not recognized by the West. I'm talking about what we consider as irregular in the Western world. Of course, there is points of contacts in secret, but Chinese Freemasonry is a completely different world, ritualistically speaking, and also they picked up on the traditions of the Freemasons from the West, as they do with everything else. The Chinese just ripped off the concept, but they just picked up they ripped off the symbols, because the secret societies already existed from a long, long time before.
Okay, so the game of what is the game?
So the Dragon family, basically, main resources are made in Macau, where there is the, as you may know, it used to be also a Portuguese kind of colony until a few years back, and now it's gone back to China. And then inside Macau, they make so much money, and they share it also with the Jews, who opened up also some big casinos through this big Jew guy who is in America, who is the owner of the biggest casinos in Las Vegas. This is dirty money. You will say, what is it with casinos and with gambling? Chinese gamble. You know how much they gamble?
Don't know.
More than you think. And so gambling is at the basis of this money that the Dragon family assets are, of course, together with drugs. But but it's actually the gambling, the main profit sources. And this Neil guy who was giving the information together with Fulford, you heard about him, no?
Yes, Neil Kanan, yeah.
He's a CIA agent, used to be involved with some very... He's a fifth-level CIA agent. He's not very high up in the CIA kind of hierarchy.
Right.
He was doing quite well in the Kissinger years, in the Bush years, in the 70s. Then he had a little bit to do, I think, with the Iran-Contra affair. I don't know if you remember that. The Iran-Contra affair was a bit of a scandal. And he himself is just trying to make a buck, but apparently even the CIA is kind of letting him loose, because he's been working and doing some dirty work for the NSA and for General Alexander. And he used, actually, I showed them in one of my books, a mail where Neil Kennel is threatening me, mentioning Alexander, saying he will, you know, otherwise go to Alexander. And I just, you know, ignored his threats, because I know that the guy, he has these contacts and everything, but I mean, I also have my own.
Okay, who do you think, before we go to questions, obviously one question leads to another one, who do you think is out there actually telling the truth and doesn't have an alternative motive?
I mean, there is some courageous journalists from time to time who do some great work. It depended who the sources are, because, of course, when you relay on an external source and you can't go directly to the front. I mean, I try to get my inside information the closer to the source possible, you understand? Because I know that then it's always difficult to be, you know, to take, you know, a very firm position if the information you are having is not... I mean, I am not like David Icke. If somebody comes to me and says, I've been sacrificed, whatever, assisting to sacrifice of this and that, I've been brainwashed, and then they claim to be a witness to this and that, I mean, I want to see evidence, and this evidence has to be very serious evidence, because I myself have been within the structure, so I know the structure. You can't fool me.
Yeah.
So I will immediately say a couple of names and immediately say, see if this person is telling the truth or not, because they know these names or they know the structure from inside. And it happens from time to time that I get some people who genuinely want to give me some great from within the structure. And of course, that's great, because then I can cite these sources, and I can also, they give me evidence and documents and photos to prove what they're saying. Otherwise, I don't give them much thought, because they can be disinformation agents. But I mean, you should, I think, out there very much study the credible sources that are closer to whatever is said. And at that point, then make your mind up. You can find some very interesting stuff, even from, you know, the mainstream sources, if you know where to look. You know, that's what they teach also in the intelligence schools.
Okay, well, we'll go over to the questions, and we have quite a few, so we'll try and do a quick fire round with the questions as best we can. Steve?
Yeah, it's all great information, powerful stuff. I'm learning lots here as well. You've actually answered, Leo, there's several questions here, and through what you've been saying there and what you've been just kind of kicking about with Alan, a lot of the questions have actually been answered. So I'm going to skip over them. I'm just going to go to the ones that you haven't touched on yet. This one came in from Joan McGuire. Joan is wondering, if Leo knows how the system works, then can he tell us what we should be doing?
What you should be doing, I've been saying it for years. First of all, you should try to make yourself more independent possible from the outside world, creating your own microcosm if possible. If you think that you can actually fight the system, well, you're in for some bad times, because I myself, even with public support in Italy last December, when I attempted a sort of revolution, which even went on the mainstream news, the police even took their helmets down because they were shaking people in Turin. I don't know if you remember, there was a big manifestations. But even then, at one point, they came to me and they just shut me up. And they said, you can't do this in Italy, and I have to just say, okay. Because otherwise the solution was simply that they will lock me up and they will never release me again. The police broke in at 9 o'clock in the morning, and they brought me somewhere, and they injected me, and they started to say, you know, and they kept me there for like 12 days. My lawyer finally, after I think it was 12 days, managed to get me out of there. And this is just to tell you the kind of threat, if you start to talk the truth, if people wake up to the truth, it can be a revolution. Of course it can be a revolution, but at that point you have to act upon what you see. You can't just say, okay, because then you want to change society. As in Italy, I've started with my publications from 2012, people have become acknowledged with subjects. I've sold something like 30,000 books only in Italy, another 60,000 in Japan. Those people have became the subjects discussed within the books, and also the evidence that I gave with the external citations, verifiable information. This is where we have to go with the conspiracy world if we want to actually make people aware, make it more credible. For the people out there, if they want a simple answer in what they should do, well, I think they should get the hell out of Europe. After 2020, there is no hope for Europe. It's doomed.
Okay. Again, as Alan said, one question kind of leads to another. With the fact that you've been doing this, you've been given the information, you've been basically told not to do it, you've been shut up, as you say, you were taken away for 12 days and injected. So people are obviously watching what you're saying, they're monitoring the information you're giving out. How far do you think they will let you go? I mean, obviously there are certain things that you cannot say, probably very, very important things. I mean, I'm guessing if you were to go and say something that they deem as you know, you've crossed the line, they'd probably take you out of the picture. You could be dead in the morning. I mean, why do you think you're still alive?
I tell you, the last time they did this, because it was very recent, it was in February of this year, it happened. And then I immediately, soon after I left, and I went to the United States, because I really wanted to really forget about this terrible episode, and also because I knew that the power of the Italian government was nothing compared to the power of the European Parliament, which is held together by the occult power of the Bilderberg, and these people completely hated me, wanted to get me out of the picture politically, because I was involved politically here in Italy. I actually participated also to the elections. And so I tried to make people and more people aware. At one point I went even on mainstream TV in the afternoon, and that's when they really, I thought they could kill me after what I said there. Because there I brought out a certain subject regarding a terrorist attack that was in Italy in the 70s, the tragedy Piazza Fontana. And I mentioned the people who were behind it at a political level and also together with the United States. And that, of course, didn't go down very well. So there was complete panic. I mean, for 3 hours, my Facebook was suspended. There were people, you know, calling me. There was, you know, they were trying. I mean, after 10 minutes, I had a bunch of people with a knife surrounding me and I had to escape. You know, and was near where I transmitted with the TV show. Suddenly I found myself surrounded because it was a live show from a square in Italy. And suddenly I found myself surrounded by people who were pointing a knife at me. And this was, you know, and I had to leave. So, I mean, it was, I went through some moments pretty scary. And in the end, I understood that there is at the moment for me no possible revolution because the people simply don't want to be awaken with certain things because it will mean a complete change in their life. I mean, a complete change in their life means that, first of all, you don't have to rely anymore on money. You have to rely so on yourself or maybe on the food you grow, on the animals you have, and you have to go back to basically being able to be completely independent at an agricultural point of view, you know, because you can grow your own thing. And also being independent, but these days is very difficult. And at one point, you really feel beaten up by the system. But I try to fight them with my books, especially now I decided to bring out my books in the U.S. and not anymore in Italy also, because it's not safe for me to bring out my books anymore in Italy. And I had this, you know, I mean, threats, I had to put in lawyers. I mean, they created so many problems for me that I think it's much better to publish in the U.S. And of course, the U.S. has their own problems. The U.S. is not a free place. They have their own problems. But when it comes down to the freedom of speech and the freedom of what you want to write, definitely it's in a better position than Italy, for example.
Yeah. Again, a good information. I agree with everything you've said. I'm sure it's been very scary at times when you come out of a place after giving a TV show and people are there with knives. Well, I mean,
These are things that are these are things that are cited. There is Huffington Post, there is serious publications like newspapers that wrote about my involvement in the revolution of last December and what happened. I mean, these things have gone to a mainstream media level in Italy at one point. So what they did is that when they saw that the people were actually with me, because they saw on TV, actually they took the microphone from me at one point. After, my second speech on TV, they actually, the responsible from the TV station took the microphone from me and everybody in Italy saw it. And they got really angry. They said, how is possible? We don't have freedom of speech in Italy? No, you don't have the freedom of speech. Because the thing is, until Lyon Zagami was broadcast, recorded on the TV, that was okay. Because they could censor me and just decide to put what they wanted. And so every time, you know, I was working, for example, on Berlusconi's TV channels at the national level in Italy, I had to always relate with these authors and their approval. And then instead, when I was live, that was a different thing because they couldn't stop me. And so they always avoided to have me live on TV. But the moment they had me live on TV, I decided to go and accuse directly the person who is most responsible. And that's the president of Italy at the moment. So I just, I came up with some very heavy things regarding him and regarding the state of affairs in Italy. And of course that was, and I said to the journalist who was in the studio while I was talking from the square, you are sold out to the system. So that's why you don't want to say anything. And the director of the program came to me and said, but you are one of us. You are a bourgeois. You're not from the people, you know, you are from the elite, you know, you want to say, why are you doing this? Why are you upsetting everybody?
Yeah.
I said, because I personally, I am an independent person. I don't rely on what the elite has given me from birth. I rely on myself. And even if the rest of my family dislikes me, which probably most of the time they do, I don't care, you know, as long as my wife is happy, me and my wife are happy, I'm happy.
Leo, if you got a chance to do the same thing again on live TV, would you say the same information again, or would you fear for your safety or the safety of your wife or other family members?
I think that I'm obliged to, if they give me the possibility to say this truth. I don't think they will ever give me the chance. If not Italy, there might be a coup d'etat at one point, because it's impossible that they will give me another chance like that. I don't mind. I mean, I don't want to be necessarily in the eye of the people. So that kind of publicity that went around me with being on the mainstream press and stuff, I don't care about that stuff, because usually they try to manipulate, and make you political. Mine is of course, I want to say that to the truth to the people, and that is the main reason why I did this political involvement, because we are fighting at the European level here in Italy. Since the euro has been put into place, we are in poverty. And at the European level, the only ones who are gaining out of it is Germany. But because the German structure is the structure which is prevailing over the others, even at a Bilderberg level. The Bilderberg was even created by a Nazi, but it includes all the royal families. And of course, the royal families are subject to the most old and ancient tradition, which resides in Germany, the one of the Sacred Roman Empire. The European Union, like the prophecy actually states, and this is in league also with the prophecies, is definitely the empire of the Antichrist, as well as the US, of course, yeah. But it's part of this New World Order scenario.
You just touched on something there when you spoke of the royals, and I actually have a question here that came in earlier from Matt. Matt is wondering, in relation to the royal family, do you know, are they connected to the Illuminati? Are they Illuminati? And are they child molesters and paedophiles?
I don't know about who is the actual child molester or paedophile, because, I mean, I don't follow them in their bedrooms, yeah. Fortunately. No, what I can say is that there is a long Masonic tradition. In Balmoral, they usually have a lodge, but there is lodges connected with the royal family. I mean, the United Lodge of England responds to the Queen of the Craft, which is the Queen of England, and of course the cousin is the Duke of Kent. I mean, they are Masonry. They are, yeah, the institution of Masonry. So there is, you can't really shind one from the other. It's not like, then there is people who marry into this because they want to obtain something. People like Bono, the singer from U2.
Yeah.
He's the worst globalist that could ever come out. A really despicable person, like Brian Eno also criticized him recently. And it's very interesting the criticism he moved against Bono, because he says he's not like he used to be. He's meddling in things that has nothing to do with him. But of course, since he joined the Bohemian Grove, and so he joined what they do there, and they do a lot of crazy pedophile activities inside there, and prostitutes and all kinds of stuff. But it's the same things that go on in the Vatican. So it's not like I must say that regarding the pedophile lot, probably they are the ones which are at the top of the pyramid. Of course, there is also people in all the institutions at the top level, especially in the UK at a conservative level. There is a lot of pedophiles, and we know that also from a lot of investigations that came in the last couple of years, also since the Jimmy Savile case. But there is a lot of people that are still covering up. There is a lot of perversion in the institutions, of course.
No, that's there's definitely a lot of that. And I think
it reflects in their moral character, and the hypocrisy, because they should just not be so hypocritical. And that is what I really criticize, of course. There can be retaliations from time to time against my persona. I don't say. I also live in very modest way compared to how I could have lived if I followed up in what in what they wanted me to do. I could have had companies, money, a lot of cars, a lot of this and that. But, I mean, I'm quite happy with the little I have, and at least I can go to sleep at night with a clear conscience.
Okay, just to get in touch and base, I did a little bit of research, obviously, about yourself on the web as well, and being kind of a devil's advocate, there are people who have their opinion based on your background, and they question that. And why would they do that? I mean, is there any reason why they would be attacking you?
Listen, every public person has people attacking them, so this is already one thing. On top of that, I must say that when I came to the public arena, no, on the internet with my first blog in 2006, that then was picked up by David Hike soon after, and then it became kind of, you know, I became involved with various people like Alexis Mansky, the investigator. Well, I can say that immediately, as soon as I went to the public level, the agents that were more active against me on the internet were the ones from the Ordo Templi Orientis. I think because of their character, the Ordo Templi Orientis is not a big group worldwide. It's about 4,000 individuals. But they're very active on the internet. They're very active in music, in culture, in trends, in things. So they kind of like to be in the key positions also within Freemasonry, unfortunately. And they have infiltrated Freemasonry, not in Ireland, that I know, but in the UK, in Scandinavia, especially in Sweden. I mean, all these people that who are involved in this infiltration, everything is exposed in my publication. I actually show their photos, their documents, the times they meet. I mean, that's the difference with the work or other divulgers. I thank, of course, David Icke for making my some of my articles known back in 2006. But we differ in the way that I base my accusations on reality. So yeah. On something I have viewed. Of course, it can be also my interpretation of things, because I can view something and view it in a completely different way than you, no?
Yeah,
we might be in the same room and you think one thing, I think the other.
Yeah, and a lot of the time it's based on our belief system and the knowledge that we have at that time. So that's how we kind of form an opinion. I think Steve has more questions there. Steve, you have more questions?
More questions than you could shake a stick at. And I'm okay. Just going through the chat as well. I'm gathering more. Earlier on, we spoke about the Pope. I know we touched on it briefly, Leo, and Shane was wondering, can you ask Leo, why is the last Pope, why has he resigned, and why is he hiding away in the Vatican? Is that something you might know the answer to?
Absolutely. I mean, there is, as I said, I just wrote a book that it's basically based on all this struggle, of both Ratzinger and Pope Francis, because they are both, you know, together. He's now the Pope Emeritus. How did he become the Pope Emeritus? Of course, he was at the end blackmailed to go out. The Jesuits, being in charge of the intelligence of the Vatican, had to take in first person the position of power. In fact, for the first time in history, we have a Jesuit Pope. Ratzinger can't really go out of the Vatican, and I don't think he wants to go out of the Vatican, because there's a lot of people after him, also at the judicial level. Though, I mean, they have tried to set up improbable causes, tribunal acts, against him, but they haven't managed, because in any case, they are the members of a sovereign state, and he will never be in any way attacked because he's a member of a sovereign state. So there is no will and there is no possibility for further inquiries in certain things. I can say that in any case, Ratzinger at the moment lives very much in a sort of Liberace style, with his little dogs, his little poodles, his piano playing, and his companion, Monsignor Georg. And that's it, you know. I mean, there is also a very powerful gay lobby in the Vatican. The main problems in the Vatican are the gay lobby, the financial lobby, which is the Masons of the Vatican, and of course they both are part of some Masonic body, which is being created inside the Vatican after the Second World War, which is the Grand Lodge Ecclesia. But there is also satanic sects that pick up people and draw them in even more in the Illuminati, what we define as the Illuminati, the sectarian activities, the satanic activity that goes around in the Vatican. That is really very dangerous stuff. There is human sacrifices involved. There is all kinds of scandals, like the Manuela Orlandi scandal and many others of people disappearing. And there is a great child prostitution ring that goes right inside the Vatican. They pick up Romanian kids from the street and bring them directly in the Vatican with these ambulances that are like fake ambulances. They park in these areas where the poor people reside, especially Romanians, and they pick them up, offer them some money, and bring them directly in the Vatican for their pedophile acts, which are in not only acts of sexual depravation, but are also ritualistic acts, because they also mix the two things, you know, to give it to give themselves also justification, I guess.
Yeah.
But also because they found, especially when Crowley founded in 1913 the Gnostic Mass, that was the point in which he created an alternative for the people who wanted to go in a more liberal Catholic Church view. That's why he actually didn't pass on the legacy of his church within the OTO as we know it today, but he passed it on to some representatives of what was the liberal Catholic Church. We have found that the liberal Catholic Church in Belgium was, for example, the base for a series of scandals and cover-ups in pedophilia, but also because Crowleyanity was spread, like Michael S. Rose wrote in his book Goodbye, Good Men, which was quite prophetic. It came out 10 years ago, actually 12 years ago, talking already about all the possible deviations within the Catholic Church, because in the seminaries in the 70s and 80s it was very spread, starting from the 60s when they started to spread Crowleyanity. Remember the 60s, Crowley was a very big pop hero, with the Beatles putting him on the cover, Rolling Stones and Sympathy for the Devil and Kenneth Anger, and there was a lot of culture going around the devil, no? And at that point it became very cool, but also he has his own religion within the OTO. It's called the Gnostic Catholic Church. And they are an actual hierarchy which is constituted like a church, and it actually confronts with many other Gnostic realities worldwide that don't usually recognize the Catholic Gnostic Church of Crowley, because they know that it's built upon a complete depravation and perversion. But imagine that in the U.S. they even managed to rent official Masonic lodges to do these Gnostic Catholic masses. And there was a pope, the interesting figure, maybe not many people know, but the lineage, what is known as the apostolic succession of Pope Bergoglio, Lord Mario Bergoglio, Pope Francis, depends from Cardinal Rampolla. Cardinal Rampolla was a Freemason and a member of the Ordo Templi Orientis. In fact, in 1903, during the conclave, he was supposed to be elected Pope, but it was the Kaiser himself, I think, I don't remember the name exactly of the Kaiser, I think it was Joseph II, but he managed to stop the election of Cardinal Rampolla by showing that he was a member of the OTO. So he was a member of the OTO even before the arrival of Crowley, and that's why Crowley acknowledges him in 1919 amongst the members of the OTO, and also as the saints of his Gnostic Catholic Church. So there was a moment in time already more than 100 years ago in 1903 where a Freemason and also a member of the Ordo Templi Orientis was about to become Pope. Of course, then we had in 1958 with John 23rd, the Papa Roncalli, we had in 1958 the first Masonic Pope, the first Freemason to become Pope, Roncalli, who was initiated in Istanbul. And then, and it was also Rosicrucian. Then we have Pope Montini. He was also a Freemason, and he's gonna think also that Roncalli now it's like here we're talking about Freemasons who are becoming saints now. So it's very incredible, this, you know, and of course it's very incredible that nobody wants to acknowledge this at a public level. So the apostolic succession of Pope Bergoglio depends from a Satanist. And this is clear. You can just go on the internet, make your research. It will take a little bit of time, but you will find the credible sources, and you will find that what I'm saying is true. So at that point, what are you going to do?
Okay.
You're going to say, I don't believe in this rubbish. That's what you should say.
Well, it's all down to facts and research. Steve has a few more questions for you there, and we're just kind of keeping an eye at the time as well. So, Steve, do you want to ask them questions there?
I shall remain as well. Yeah, Leo, Chris asked a question earlier. He knows of a politician in Italy. He can't remember the chap's name, but he wants to know, do you know anything about the politician, the Italian politician, who was pushing for ET disclosure?
Ah, sure, it's my friend Giuseppe. I was behind that, because if you go on the internet, you can find also a conference we made, me and him, and together with Roberto Pinotti, who is responsible for Kuhn. He works for Stephen Greer, the guy who does the disclosure project in the U.S. Yeah. And basically what happened was that me and Battino were working together at a political level, and before the term of his legislation, Giuseppe decided to basically do this thing, because he knew on the 21st of December, 2012, there wasn't the end of the world, the Maya prophecy, yeah, but there was the end of the Italian government of basically of Berlusconi, that then gave in into the one of Mario Monti, and at that point there would have been the elections. The elections, of course, were something that I participated directly, but before terminating his legislation, the last thing to be proposed in Parliament was this ET question time. And he actually based it on a lot of evidence and facts that he found. And so he put in this question time, this very interesting. And the crazy thing was that he actually later on was, they threatened his life. He actually had to go to the Italian secret police, Digos, and then they arrested somebody, because they actually threatened him. The strange thing was that he was a politician for a party called Italia dei Valori, who now is not in Parliament anymore, but him and Barbato decided to do the proposal, and in the week following the proposal, all the left-wing newspapers attacked him like crazy. Just the left-wing newspapers. I don't know why. Probably left-wing people don't like UFOs. I don't know. But in any case, they attacked him so... And then there was this guy who started to threaten him and sent him a message saying he would shoot him in the legs. And so at the end, Giuseppe Vatino managed, though, to get the police to intervene, and the guy was arrested. But in any case, I'm very glad you brought up this, because in Italy I started a book with this thing called The Maestro Invisibile, Nuovo Ordine Mondiale, that was published last year. And also, as I said, I'm a long time collaborator and friend of Giuseppe Vatino, so I'm glad that at an international level, because this happened just after Medlev went on TV and said that thing that really started the whole problem also with Russia. Because if you think about it, when is that the problems with Russia started? The problem with Russia started with Medlev was caught talking about the UFOs. You remember Medlev, the president of Russia, when he talked about the UFOs?
That's right. I remember watching the video clip, yeah.
Okay. Soon after that, me and Vatino said, okay, we're going to ask Medlev, you know, if this thing is real, you know, like a confirmation of what he said.
Yeah.
And he confirmed it.
Yeah, he did,
and
yeah.
He not only confirmed it, but he invited us to Russia, to Moscow. So he invited the whole delegation, which will have included also me, to go to Moscow. And, I mean, but if you want to know more about we didn't end up going to Russia, of course.
Can I just interject here for a minute? I just want to, for our listeners who don't understand, you know, we have Mick from Liffey Sound, I think, was on earlier on. I don't know whether he's on now. He might be still listening, tuned in. But basically, Medvedev, the president at the time, said, he came out and said, there are ETs on the planet, and more than what we think. And this was on video, but was in Russian. So I emailed Mick from Liffey Sound, and I said, basically I said, does anybody know how to translate Russian? And Mick had a friend whose girlfriend was Russian. So Mick got the girl to actually translate the Russian what was said. And she confirmed that what he said was exactly right, what the script about him turning around and saying that there are ETs on the planet. And this was the president of Russia at the time.
Yeah, well, but he wasn't the only one to have said it in recent times. We have also that woman, that ex-president of the bank, I don't know, of the World Bank, I don't know, part of the World Bank, I don't know, I remember her name. But she's also, was also talking about this presence of an ET lineage or different race within the Vatican. I don't know if you heard about that.
No, was that Christine Lagarde?
Yes. Yeah. No, not Christian again. No.
Oh, well, Karen Hudis.
Yeah, Karen Hudis. Yes.
Yeah, no, I've seen the interview. Karen has been on the show, yeah.
Ah, yes. So basically, she also said something very interesting. I don't know what kind of information and where she got it from, what kind of sources she had. But I must say that the interesting thing was that after me and Giuseppe starting to also do these conferences in Latina last year, some very strange things started to happen because we were like surrounded always by people from the police, the secret service all the time. They were always curious of what we were doing. The whole thing got also interconnected with our political struggle, so it was really strange. The whole thing, definitely.
Exactly, Steve. You got another question there. I think it was about Kevin Annette.
Yeah, well, that's on the list as well. Yeah, Joan is wondering, Leo, what's your thoughts on Kevin Annette?
I don't have any thoughts. I don't know very well the subject, so I will not know very well what to say.
Oh, basically, well, Kevin Annette and his team are basically trying to bring down the Catholic Church because of what went on with the pedophilia and everything else.
I mean, you're talking about this, which specific organization here?
I forget what the organization
is.
Is the
one based in
Canada? He's from Canada.
Ah, from Canada, yes, yeah. From Canada. Because there is a lot of organizations that are basically trying to do the same thing at the moment. I think that though what happened a couple of years ago when they actually there was an international rogatory being put down for people like Ratzinger and others in the Vatican, and then suddenly at one point they just quit it because the lawyer said he thought that otherwise they will have like a precedent where they will win, you know, and they didn't want that to happen. That was a little bit of a, I think, thin answer. I think that it is very important to understand that at the moment there is a lot of people who want to confront the Vatican, but the Vatican can only be confronted at the state level because it's a foreign state. I have people within the Italian police who have been investigating certain pedophiles, certain things. But when it comes down to entering the Vatican walls, they say, Leo, we can't do anything about it. We know they reside there, but we can't. If they are inside there, we can't do anything about
exactly.
it.
Exactly, yeah.
The whole, before the 1 year before the election of the Pope, you know, there was also the scandal of the crowd that led, the butler of the Pope with all these revelations. Very few people know that at the same time, Cardinal Bertone, who is the one who refused further inquiries from the Murphy Commission, Cardinal Bertone, he started his own inquiry so he could then blackmail people and get to stay in certain position of power within the Vatican. So what did he do? Together with with the top general who is in charge of the Vatican security, they monitor after 9 p.m. everybody that was coming in and out of the Vatican walls. And of course, they monitored pedophiles, drug dealers, a lot of drug dealers, a lot of male prostitutes. And all these things could be used after, during the papal elections, as material that you can use. Because once you have intelligence on somebody, you can use it against him, of course. And, it becomes part of the games of power. So it is very sad that the Vatican is this way, and it's very sad that people still believe in this charade.
Exactly.
I mean, I was in Ireland now many years ago. I haven't been in Ireland since 1986, I've been in Ireland a long time ago. I was studying for a period at Trinity College. When I was there, I saw really that still in the 80s, there were some very conservative attitudes in the Catholic world that were even more conservative than what we will have here in Italy. And I thought, this is ridiculous. Why do the Irish don't understand that the whole thing is a scam? I mean, well, don't they wake
but
up?
We've said that time and time again, Leo. We say that, even after the Ryan report with all the exposure of the paedophiles over here and the priests abusing the kids, and there's still people don't see that the church is just one big bank, and each church is just like a branch of the bank, and they just want your money. And it's just a scam, and we've said that before now.
It's not only that. If it was only that, the money thing, it would be, they want also the energy, the egregoric energy, what is created by the prayers, by the things, and also the energy of the youth, the children that, of course, fall into their arms, and we know what happens to them. All this is, of course, the hypocrisy of the Catholic Church. But the Catholic Church now is working within the New World Order to a more global project, a universal church. And that is what I reveal for the first time with very much with accuracy in my new book that will come out worldwide in April of 2015, Pope Francis, the last pope, because for the first time we show the construction of Vatican II near Rome. We show this place where they are constructing this massive temple where they want to reunify all the religions. We also show that it's built on the same plan and the same project, at architectural level as Göbeklitepe, which is this antediluvian site in Turkey, which was found in the middle of the 90s, which is supposed to be used by these secret societies for thousands of years. So here we're talking about a secret society transmitting knowledge for thousands of years. And very interesting that the actual discovery of this information came from an Italian politician, Rumor, who was the cousin of a five-time prime minister in Italy and from the Christian Democrat Party. And he came up in his archives. We have found so much interesting evidence that will shock the people when they will read the book. So, I mean, people will finally understand that this is not a conspiracy theory. This is historical evidence that we are digging here. So that's why I prefer to work with an archaeologist or an historian than with a conspiracy theorist. Because if now we need to be taken seriously, we have to demonstrate that this conspiracy goes on for thousands of years. But you're not going to be able to demonstrate that if you don't have historians and archaeologists, on your side.
Totally. I tell you, we have about 10 minutes left, so I'd like to kind of look at any positives that we can take out of this information, Leo, and look at what is good that's happening. You know, is there any kind of a chink in the armor regarding the New World Order? Is there anything from a bigger scale, a bigger level, more energy? Because we have heard the kind of the opposite to that on a bigger scale, on a global scale, that there are energy changes taking place on the planet, and it's only a matter of time that the negative side will subside. Now, I don't know. I mean, what's your take on it?
I think that at a spiritual level, like I told you even earlier, definitely is a change. There is an understanding that is growing in the population, more awareness. But, I mean, it's very difficult to get out of our cage mentality, because we are in a cage mentality all our lives. When we don't have the certainties coming from our bank account, from our card, from our from our football match, or whatever is letting the daily life go. I mean, all these things are made so they can manipulate you. Even the world, the Hollywood world, and I'm coming out in November with a book here in Italy dedicated to the Illuminati and Hollywood, which I just wrote by staying several months in LA and interviewing people and getting to know things directly from the source. And I discovered that there is a massive plan of action that has been going on for over 100 years in Hollywood, which is diabolical. It's really diabolical, and the people are completely brainwashed left, right, and center. So the positive thing, is a switch off the whole show, switch off the TV, switch off the cinema, switch off the internet if you are connected to sites of rubbish, try to connect to the information that you regard as serious, but try to create yourself, as I said before, a microcosm which needs to be positive. The positive thing is that once you realize who they are, I mean, either they kill you or either you can find yourself to live in freedom by accepting the limitations that you have outwards and trying to create your own free world within, you know, at least your own household. Because it's these days is even difficult to keep out of your household these people, because they increasingly get into your life through Facebook, through this, through this. They are more and more into your life. So trying to keep them out of your household and have at least the freedom of spirit in the household, you know, and have a laugh also about this thing. Because you have to also have a laugh about a comedy kind of approach about the whole thing. It's a great comedy. It's a divine comedy, like Dante would have said, you know. So I think that we have to be mature enough also to laugh about certain aspects of it. I mean, they are really ridiculous, these people, most of the time. Just watch them. I mean, what they're wearing in the Vatican, what they're wearing in their daily life when they go to the office, how they're behaving, the falsity of their lives, the hypocrisy of their lives, you know. Maybe they have 10 lovers, they sleep with the little kid, and this, and then they bring themselves up as the, and portray themselves like the ultimate, you know, honest person. I mean, we don't have to be fooled anymore by appearances. I think that the problem is still that in this age, in 2014, we are connected to the appearance of the subject, to judging.
Well, we've had that over in the UK. We've had stars who have had, you know, people have known them to be a fantastic celebrity, and butter wouldn't melt in their mouth, and all of a sudden it comes out that they had actually been playing around with kids in the younger days. Rolf Harris comes to mind, and Jimmy Savile, and a few other stars as well.
And it's not the only ones. Of course, there is many more. But it's because in the British society, they are stuck up. I mean, fortunately, I'm talking to you that are Irish. But really, guys, a British society is stuck-up society made of people who are not honest with themselves. You know, they are false. They have made out of falsity a virtue in England. I mean, I really support the possibility for Scotland to get independent. But independent from what? Because now we are all stuck in this new world order scenario. So, I mean, it's very difficult to get independent from the European Union and all the rest. I mean, here we are talking about if we had to utopically, you know, break up from all this, no? We should break up from the NATO treaty, the European Union. Yeah, I mean, we're talking here about breaking up from everything, because they're all in league with what the Christians call the devil. It's all in league with evil. All this is evil. There's nothing good about the United Nations. There's nothing good about the European Union. There's nothing good about any institution that they've been promoting. And so the great result, what is it? That I, Italian, or you, German, or the student can go for a student course abroad, or can be facilitated to find their job abroad, whatever. But we see that this new world order has a Nazi upbringing. So, of course, they will respect, first of all, the place where Nazism is born. And that place is Austria and Germany. So Germany is, of course, still now a Nazi nation. It is Nazis, complete Nazism, to carry on as they are in Europe. They are making the rest of Europe poor, and they are getting richer and richer, because they didn't conquest us anymore with the weapons. Now they control our bank accounts, and they control our banking system, because they are the ones who are printing the notes. The Frankfurt, the bank, the central bank is in Frankfurt. It's not in Ireland, it's not in Italy, it's not in France. So they are the ones who are cashing in. They are the ones who are printing the sovereignty is being lost. We have given our sovereignty. Do you use the euro in Ireland?
Yes, we do, yeah.
Yeah, you guys give the sovereignty to a bunch of Germans. Now, well, I think that if we were to bring back the scenario, you know, like to people like Churchill, to you know, people who really defended us against the Nazis in 2014 and seen what they've been able to do in the last few decades, I think they did a great job. And who founded the Bilderberg was the Prince Bernard, who was a Nazi. And he did it specifically together with the CIA so they could take in all the Nazis that, of course, were still able to recycle in Europe. The other ones they would bring to South America. The rat lines, of course, were taken care of by the Vatican. The Knights of Malta, they bring out the people, the cruel experimenters, you know, like, you know, the one Dr. Mengele, for example, and they bring him in a safe haven. I mean, all this is being done against us, and it's time to wake up. So
okay.
I don't want to say that the race, the German race, is wrong, because I myself come from there also, as all the aristocrats, and my symbol is in the cathedral cone. But I am really shameful for what they are doing to the rest of Europe by a dictatorship which is made of technocracy nowadays, and it's not a dictatorship, of course, of Adolf Hitler. We don't need Adolf Hitler these days. They don't need Adolf Hitler in Germany. These days they have Merkel, who is somebody who participates to this plan. And she's been even awarded the Kalergi plan. Do you know what is the Kalergi award? Do you know what is the Kalergi plan?
No.
Well, I think you should study a bit, because the Kalergi plan was created by a guy called Kalergi 100 years ago, and is an award also given to people like Angela Merkel. And he has devised, he was an aristocrat, one is seen as one of the founders of the European Union. You have to study the history of the European Union if you want to fight the European Union. That's what I say to Irish people as well as Italians. Let's not be superficial. Let's see where this history is starting from. There was a guy who was, of course, very Nazi. He was half Japanese, but he was of the aristocratic Habsburg context. He was born in Austria. Kalergi created in the 20s the idea for a united Europe. That's why the Kalergi Award is still given to the European leaders. And he devised a plan called the Kalergi Plan, in which he is methodically destroying, is creating a genocide of the European people, methodically, by invading them with Muslims.
Okay.
And destroying the race. This is it's not me talking about it. You just have to go on the internet and write Kalergi Plan, study who was Kalergi. And of course, I'm saying this as a historian, so you can understand better the evil roots of Europe.
No, we have come across that. But I'll tell you, Leo, we've reached that time of the evening, unfortunately. We have to finish up. But, you know, a big thank you for coming on to the show. That's been great information. And it's definitely food for thought. I think people on the chat room had different opinions.
Yeah, I mean, if you have some other questions, I will be glad to answer them. No problem. I hope that I was clear with what I gave you up until now.
No, that's fine. No, we just ran out of time. We have to finish off the show. So we've no more time left. But again, a big thank you. I mean, I'm sure what we can do is if we have the questions, we can post them in the Skype. And if Leo wants to reply to them, then we'll have them and we can read them out. Okay, that's what we're going to do, Leo. We're going to copy and paste the questions in the Skype for you, and then in your own time, you can get, if you get them back to us during the week, then we can actually read them out on next week's show, maybe, and let people know what the answer were. But again, as I say, a big thank you. I'm going to pass you off to Steve, and Steve's going to get all your details off you.
Okay.
Yeah, Leo.
Thank you very much.
It's been fun in the sun. It's been great information, powerful stuff. As Alan said, a lot of people on the chat seem to resonate with them. Some people had different opinions. Some people had, there was a lot of questions. We have popped them into the Skype chat. I have sent them over to you there. If you can answer them, that'll be fantastic. Then we can read out the answers possibly next week. But in the meantime, yeah, can you give us, well, I actually have your website here, but I have leozagami.com as your website. Is there any other media out there where people can find out more of this fascinating information that you've given us this evening?
Well, this fascinating information will be published in the entirety of its form from next year on CCC Publishing, which is a publishing company from San Francisco. You can find it on the internet. Of course, we have also great distribution for these books, which is this independent distribution from Chicago. And we are hoping that finally, by having my word also in the English-speaking word, in my written word, of course, we will be able also, there will be a better understanding also about of my work, because what you find on the internet is a lot of websites, mostly they're not authorized, just blogs, blogging my information and stuff, while instead you will be finally able from April of next year with this book, and then with the trilogy that will come out after that, and then there will be also The Invisible Master. So there is coming up in the English language five books, and I'm very much looking forward forward to have you maybe interviewing me once you read one of my books.
That'd be brilliant. That'd be fantastic. Okay, well, listen, stay with us there, Leo, for a minute. We're just going to go off to a bit of music for the musical break, and we'll be back after this.
This is Open Your Mind Radio on OYMRadio.com, UnitedWeStrike.com, and PeoplesInternetRadio.com.
Okay, and we're back. I do apologise for the choice of music. That instant replay, Dan Hartman, Alan's Top 40.
Hey, there is more music on that, Sam. Now, don't be...
I'm just playing what you have on your mouse played. Yeah. Come here, Dan Hartman. Is that... That's not something to do with the chap out of... No, it's not. The Simpsons?
I don't know.
Dan Hartman and The Simpsons?
I don't know.
Okay.
Don't know.
Right. Yeah, anyway. Alan was dancing to it anyway.
Yeah,
I was just sitting
there
twiddling my thumbs.
Yeah, we're just two old farts that like that kind of 80s music.
Hey.
What can we say? Okay, now that was interesting. Look, Leo is giving his opinion. I was hoping to get more of kind of positive information at the end, but we kind of didn't really get there, so it's a bit of a concern. But then again, I've done a lot of kind of video work research during the week, and, you know, there could be 10 guys that will argue with Leo and say, well, Leo, you know, that's great, but there's things going on a bigger level maybe you're not aware of. So, you know, it's, you know, unless we're there and we can see it and touch it and feel it and everything else, we can only say what we've researched or what we've came across. And then you cross-reference stuff as well. And even then, you can still sit in the fence and say, well, until we see it happening, we're not going to believe it. So, and that's the whole thing with the kind of the information that's out there, what resonates with you and where your mind is at the moment and your belief system. Because, you know, we've said before and people say, oh, it's fear porn. Well, it's fear porn if you see it as fear porn. That's where your mind is at. We've kind of, myself and Steve have kind of passed that stage and we just see things as information. That's really
actually, if I can just mention, you turned me on to a chap there a couple of weeks back called Wayne Dyer. And Wayne has, it's a 2-hour, I think it's in realm, 2-hour presentation on kind of life in general and how we see things and how what we look at, you know, will change based on how we perceive it and all this. It's a great 2-hour kind of little documentary, if you like, or a speech, whatever you want to call it. I don't have the link to hand. I will see if I can find it. If not, I'm sure we'll find it during the week and stick it up in the chat. But it is good to listen to him because what he says is something I posted up there in the chat earlier. It's that when you look at something, based on how you look at it is how it will be. And if you change your viewpoint on something, then what kind of reflects back to you will also change. I know it kind of sounds a little bit way out there, but he gives a good presentation and he explains it a hell of a lot better than I could ever hope to. But his name is Wayne Dyer. So check him out anyway. If not, we'll say we can try and get a link up during the week. But I know like sometimes when you have someone on and they're giving you information and it sounds doom and gloom and you perceive it that way, well, it's like the old saying goes, every cloud has a silver lining, but then again, every silver lining has a cloud, I suppose. You know, it's just how we perceive things.
Exactly, so, yeah. So be careful of our thoughts because our thoughts create our reality, as they say. Now, I'm going to give a shout out to Stephen in a place called Clark's Sports Den in Navan. The website is www.sportsden.ie. I came across this during the weekend.
Are we sponsored by them this week?
No, we're not sponsored. No, I'll tell you why. Because I didn't know they were there. They're kind of hidden away, tucked away in Navan. And they have, for preppers, they have everything. I mean, literally, you can go in. If you have a gun license, you can get a gun off them. They have crossbows. They have...
If you have a gun and no license, can you get a gun off them?
No, if you're pointing it at them, maybe they'll give you them. But they have all fishing gear and camping gear and prepper gear, and they have the whole lot really that's there. So if you're into all of that and you want to prep and you want to get stuff, and you know, I was quite impressed. A big shop with loads of stuff in it, and you have air rifles and all that kind of stuff. So if that's what you're into and you're into prepping and you're looking for gear, I was going down to kind of Blanchestown down in Dublin until I seen what he had, and I thought, going, you know, we don't need to travel that far to see, to get the stuff that you want. So I said to Stephen, ask for Stephen. I'm not saying you'll get a discount, but if you go to Stephen and say, oh, I heard you mentioned on OYM, you never know. They might give you a discount, you never know.
And did you get a discount on that AK-47 I see there in the corner?
What, all the ammo?
No, the one.
No, I didn't know. I have to get a license, I think. But, so yeah, no, just a big call out for Stephen there on Clark Sports then. Now, next week we have a chap called Captain Randy Kay, who's a super soldier and was involved with the actual space program. Now, he has been interviewed by James Gilliland, and I heard the interview, and it's very interesting. And one of the things he did say in the interview, which I thought, I mean, put it this way, we know they have technology, advanced technology, way, way, way ahead of what we see today. And one of the things that Captain Kay said is they actually have, I mean, I'm sure they studied the likes of starfish, and where starfish, when you chop off one of the legs of a starfish, it regrows again. Well, they obviously have that technology, but they're not giving it out to the general public, and they're not giving it out, they're keeping it for themselves, because Randy said, Captain Kay said that soldiers who come in off the battlefield and have part of the arm or leg missing, they can actually have it regenerated and have them back out healed and all within 24, 48 hours. And that's the kind of technology they have. So, and he's going to be talking about an awful lot more as well. So it's going to be quite interesting. See what he has to say. Again, you make up your own mind. Do a bit of research. But if you go on to YouTube and type Captain K, I'm sure you'll come across some interviews. You can have a listen and make, as I say, make up your own mind on it. But so that should be quite interesting for next week. I'm going to keep an eye on the Nasara and just see what's going on with that. I don't know whether it's, I mean, chances are it's just like, you know, hot air as usual. That's what you normally say, or there's some alternative motive behind it. But we'll just see. Out of curiosity, I'm just going to keep an eye on that. But I did learn a lesson this week. And the lesson I learned is, it doesn't matter what party you vote for. There's people out there who will think, look at one politician, and because that politician is nice, or they might do something, and they're saying, we'll vote for this person. It's the party. It's all the party whip system. And as long as people keep voting these mainstream parties in, Ireland is not going to change. We need to change. We need to move away from the mainstream parties. I gave you the example at the start of the show with the TD, Ray Butler, from Fine Gael. He lost his business. He had austerity in the early 2000s. He joined the actual Fine Gael party. And I asked him, well, why are you putting austerity on everybody else when you've had it, you've experienced it? Why aren't you stopping that? And he couldn't answer the question. Or he wouldn't answer it. So, obviously that tells me that there's a party whip system and they can't do anything. Their hands are tied. So, it's all false promises. So, you know, if you know anybody who actually voting the mainstream parties, just try and let them know. Educate them to the party whip system. And don't be afraid to email your TDs, your local TDs, where you are. And ask them questions. No harm doing that. They mightn't reply, but ask them questions. At least if you ask them a question and they don't reply to you, or they don't tell you what you want to know, you can see for yourself that they're just puppets being controlled in their party. That's it. So that's the news. What are you doing during the week, Steve?
I'm going to be shooting on down to that shop you mentioned and getting some supplies. Maybe getting all double barrel shotgun or so. No, I'm just going to keep on doing what I do, is, you know, as I said before, I'm just going to be planting some seeds and trying to wake people up. That's pretty much it.
That's it.
Okay, no problem.
What more can you do?
Okay, well, no problem. Well, we'll let Finn have the stream there. We'll finish up. So, from myself, Alan James, have a good week. Stay safe. If you have any information or any guests that you'd like to try and... If you want to send us over a link and we'll try and get them on, we were happy to do that. Lyon Zagami, again, I'm sorry for the person that I forgot your name who gave us the information. But thanks for the link and thanks for, you know, letting us know about Leo and we're getting him on the show. But otherwise, for myself, take care. Take it easy and stay safe. We'll catch you later. Bye-bye.
Yeah, take it easy. That's the order of the day. That's the doctor's orders from Dr. Allen. Okay. Yeah, okay, for myself as well, Stephen George, take it handy. Have a good week. We'll do it all again next week. And stay tuned on PIR for the dulcet tones of Vin. He's on his own, but he will be looking for callers on this for the second hour. Take care. Catch you next week. Bye-bye. Okay, you know.